actually Delva Hassan, Dato Sri Liza, Nasri Mami, Timbalan Panglima Tentera Laut, Dato Abdul Rahman, Dato Sulaimi, Dr. Amin, Dato Syed Masin, Dato Abah, Prof. Anas, Sami Hamzah, Ketua Pengarah Hisham. Terima kasih kerana menjemput saya ke program ini. I have a prepared text here. I don't know whether I want to read the full text or actually engage in some of the discussions, which was very interesting. But trying to try my best to mix within my prepared text and also answer some of the questions, which was very interesting, and I thought we should actually carry forward this discussion, particularly on future force and also on joiners and whole of government approach. Let me begin by congratulating MIDAS for the successful organization of this MIDAS conference. I've had the chance to follow some of the discussions today, and I can attest that this is a fantastic occasion, which perhaps we should have paused such a session and go into the next year when we try to implement the white paper. This is something that we should do a lot more in big groups and also in smaller groups. I think, as we are well aware, next Monday, Minister of Defence, Zabrul Masabu, is going to present the white paper to Parliament. This is the first white paper in our history, and we are into uncharted water in many ways. Uncharted waters because this is the first public explanation of the role of the armed forces and the needs for defence nationally. Why is it important? Because we are a unique nation in many ways. I think we are unique compared to our regional neighbours. We have a police force which is almost equal size, or actually bigger in terms of numbers for now, than the armed forces. And the police has a strong role compared, vis-a-vis the regional neighbours. So in the region, with the exception of Malaysia, Singapore and Brunei, other nations are actually military dominated societies. So we are different. And in those countries, you probably won't get people asking the role of the armed forces. But here, perhaps the police also will ask the role of the armed forces. So we are in a nation that needs to deal with a different sort of arrangement, institutional arrangement, which is not necessarily bad because you have civilian control over armed forces. But at the same time, the role of the armed forces has to be explained to the public, and there needs to be a lot more engagement so that the public understand our role. But at the same time, we also need to put in the context of the current strategic situation, where this is 30 years after the end of the fall of the Berlin Wall, 30 years after the Hagai Accord, and we need to think of what to do in the very delicate current situation, like what E. Hamza has just presented this morning, and also other speaker has presented. So as we celebrate the landmark achievement of having a white paper, or presenting a white paper, it's important to bear in mind this is only the beginning. This is the beginning of a long journey of rethinking and also rearranging what we want to do. The real work has just only begun. Many reforms that have been identified in the white paper will require our diligent effort to ensure that it is properly implemented in order to achieve aspirations and vision of ourselves. To this end, it is imperative that we work together as a whole of government fashion and move ahead and join us. I think the two main themes in the white paper is whole of government approach and join us. As pointed out earlier, when the balloon goes up, actually your enemy won't identify whether you are police, custom or armed forces or air force or whatever. Basically, when a threat happens to be real, it happens. And therefore, it is important to have this whole of government approach. And this whole of government approach is particularly important for Malaysia because of the different institutional arrangement that we have. And therefore, it's important to, in terms of military, the demarcation between land, sea, air, and cyber domain is increasingly blurred and required joiners. And that was clearly illustrated by the case of Sabah, in which we have 1,400 kilometer coastline. In eastern Sabah, it's impossible for any enforcement agency to work in silo. Globally, joint commands is also increasingly becoming the trend and more and more important. I want to deal with some of the questions that was raised earlier in my impromptu reply. The white paper is not coming with the detailed planning. The white paper provides the policies. But in the implementation chapter, it has been suggested that there needs to be discussions on the joint capability. And there needs to be a committee that is checked at the highest level to ensure that long-term defense investment is agreed upon at the highest level, that is at the cabinet and also with the prime minister. Now, a lot of investment and our structure somehow doesn't necessarily fit the needs of defense. We have a budgetary arrangement, annual budget. We have a five-year plan. But defense procurement and defense investment very often goes beyond 5 years. Whether it goes to 50 years is another issue, but five-year plan may not necessarily be able to capture the needs of defense. So we have white paper, and eventually there should be a joint capability plan that is agreed upon at the highest level and funded. Just to answer the Dr. Sri Akbar's point. Previously, we have individual services plan, and also we have 4DMAF. But 4DMAF is not funded, and it's not a cabinet agreed paper. So I think that is the progress that we hope to achieve in 2020. That is, in the next year, hopefully, in implementing the aspiration of the white paper, we can actually get everyone to sit down, including getting presenting it to the cabinet and also to the prime minister as well as to the finance related ministries, so that we have a long-term capital plan funded and agreed upon by the political masters. I think that is an important step moving ahead, because if we only have plans by different services, and even you have a joint plan at the ATM level, without being agreed upon by the cabinet, it is just a statement of aspiration. Or in short, it's a wish list. So hopefully this can be achieved, and I hope MiDAS can be a catalyst or instigator in pushing that effort. Malaysia has been blessed with peace, but this is ironically making us complacent about our security situation to some extent. Security concerns have never been a factor much in the minds of our society, especially in the post-Cold War era since 1989 after the fall of the Liew War, and also post-communist era after the signing of Hagia Ikon. I'll give you an example. Urban planners in this country don't seem to factor in war, terrorist attack, climate emergency, or any crisis situation that requires mass evacuation in their planning. If they do, they will not push for military camps to be shifted away from cities. I have openly said that I'm against land swap that move military camps from urban areas to far-flung areas. Camps should be where the populations are, so that you can actually deal with the challenges that we'll face, especially in light of Marawi. In light of Marawi, it's clear that if we keep on moving camps from urban center to far-flung places, you will actually have an impact on response time. In this regard, I believe that MiDAS has an important role to play as the think tank for the Ministry of Defense. It must serve as the honest and constructive self-critic of the government, and be at the forefront of strategic thinking while helping MiDAS as well as other agencies to go forward in embracing new innovative ideas and ways of thinking. As the leading Track 2 institutions on defense issue, MiDAS also play a crucial role in our defense diplomacy effort with other countries, facilitating more frank exchanges of views with other external partners that are sometimes not possible at the official level. MiDAS must be proactive in building networks with leading think tanks in the region and serve as a window to communicate to external partners and the public. For a think tank to succeed, its most important element is the people in it. I truly believe that we must invest in our people to build a generation of researchers who will go on to become experts in their various subject matter. There should also be a constructive revolving door mechanism where the pool of talent in security sector can move across government, think tank, defense, or staff colleges, and universities so that we create synergies between these institutions and build people-to-people ties. I think this revolving door can also include retired generals who are strategic thinkers so that we can continue to benefit from their thinking, for instance, Dr. Suhaimi. I sometimes find retired generals, after they retire, they totally disappear from the scene, but I really hope that more retired generals will continue to engage in strategic discussions so that we benefit from your insights and the nation can think through some of the challenges that we face. One of the proposals put forward in the white paper is to create a security cluster where the civil servants that are trained in international affairs and security issues will be rotated among security-related agencies such as MIDAF, Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Ministry of Home Affairs, and National Security Council. We should also tap into retired generals and military officers. It is important to retain this pool of talents, and with them, the institutional memories and the depth of understanding of complexity of security challenges. I just want to share with you my view and my very short experience at the Ministry of Defense. I think we must break the silo, and we must think about how to retain and build sustainable and long-term talent pool in defense civilian. It is important to, we inherited essentially an Indian civil service structure. India's civil service structure in the sense that civil servants are all rotated in any ministries and in all ministries from federal to state to federal. But in security areas, institutional memories is very important. Institutional memories is important. The armed forces grew together from 18 years old to 60 years old. The officers know each other from 18 years old. But there's a need for a pool of people who are defense civilian and defense thinker to understand the multifaceted aspect of defense so that we can deal with defense with a long-term perspective. So as much as we train members of the armed forces, it is very important that we also have a long-term talent pool of defense civilian. And that long-term talent pool is important because in our current system, we are working on an adversarial check and balance. The civil servant in MIDAF checks on the military. Treasury and Ministry of Economic Affairs checks on the Ministry of Defense. So everyone is checking each other, but we have not actually been able to bring everyone into the same vision and same operating picture. Now, how do we do that? I think through a lot more engagement like today's, and also through a lot more long-term engagement between civilian and the armed forces, as well as with think tankers. We need to create that national vision, national understanding of defense, so that everyone sees that our role actually is together and actually is the same. I think this is the hope that I hope we can actually do. So I believe that there should be more exchanges between the military and the civilian in MIDAF. One of the suggestions that I put forward was for a military module to be introduced to new civilian staff in MIDAF, so that they can have a first-hand experience of the challenges faced by the military, which I think will be very valuable as they move on to the positions, to other positions, and so that they can make decisions that will have an impact to the boots on the ground. Ladies and gentlemen, to conclude, defending the nation is everyone's responsibility. instead of lamenting the lack of awareness among the public, the responsibility is on us to communicate better to the public on how defense matters to them. Taking cue from the white paper, let us all put our heads together on this, on the most effective way to communicate the key ideas, such as the nation of the notion of maritime nation, join us, hydro to the public. And I hope this I hope that some of the MiDAS activities next year can be structured with this goal in mind. And think of ourselves not as a convener of events or conferences, but as a convener of ideas and a thought leader. It is also through cultivating a whole of nation consciousness about security and defense that we can move forward as a peaceful, sovereign, and prosperous nation. With that, I thank you very much for your presence today, and I declare the conference closed. Thank you.